Many people dream of writing a novel, but very few people actually do it. And my next guest has done it not once, but seven times. And we're going to find out in a minute whether he's working on an eighth. Let's take a look at his first six books by Vince Flynn: Transfer of Power, Term Limits, Third Option, Executive Power, Memorial Day, Separation of Power. And now there is a new book just out this fall by Vince Flynn, Consent to Kill. And Vince Flynn is here with us in studio, a fellow University of St. Thomas grad. Thanks for being here, Vince.
Proud grad. Thanks yes, for being on the show.
It is a proud institution. Yes. We're glad to be there. Consent to Kill, I'm about halfway through it. Mm-hmm. It's, as usual, a great thriller, one that I'm a little more than halfway through, and I have no idea yet what is going to happen. Do you like creating these plots? I mean, just coming up with these creative ideas?
Well, I love to, and unfortunately, when you go on a show like this, you can't get too into the story, or you're going to give it away. This book more than any of the previous six. Something big happens in this book to the main character, and Mitch Rapp, my franchise character. He was not in the first book, Term Limits, but he's been in the next six. And about all I can say is the hunter becomes the hunted in this book, and Rapp's whole life gets turned upside down, and it's been. One of the nicest things about this is I love writing them, but each book has sold more than the other one. I just signed another contract with my publisher for four more books. This is the first one in that four-book contract. And it's nice to walk into that building in New York every time I go there and know that they're making money on me. Because you don't want to be one of these authors who's they're getting huge returns and all of a sudden you're orphaned and you never publish another book again.
And you know, Mitch Rapp, one of the reasons why it has been so successful, people have really taken a liking to this character. And he's based on, I think, a lot on what a lot of Americans would like to see of people in the CIA. Do you ever get tired of the same character?
You know, he was I invented him back in 96, you know, so well prior to 9/11, and my thought back then was this Islamic radical fundamentalism is going to be a serious problem. And I felt that, you know, we needed a guy like Mitch Rapp to be over there, and this is going to sound harsh, but, you know, to be over there killing these people, assassinating them before they came after us. You know, Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden, they'd already tried to take down the towers once. They'd hit the Khobar Towers over in Saudi Arabia. They'd hit the USS Cole. And I thought, we can't just sit here and play defense. And I think that's one of the biggest reasons why these books sell, is people read it and they applaud. Privately, they can fantasize about a guy like Mitch Rapp doing that. Publicly, people don't like talking about what our government should or shouldn't have done. You know, there was not the political will prior to 9/11 to go assassinate this person, other than a few thousand people in Washington and the national security community and the special forces community and a couple of writers like myself.
How has 9/11 changed the way you write the plots of these books? Because in many ways, 9/11 was almost a script people couldn't envision.
Well, prior to 9/11, I had written one of the novels. One of my characters was ruminating about what was coming, and she said, you know, the wave of Islamic radical fundamentalism was coming to America, and it wasn't a question of a matter of if, but when, and it would be thousands of people, not hundreds of people, who would die when it happened. And so I didn't know it was going to be something like the towers, but I felt sooner or later it was going to hit us, and it was going to hit us hard. Prior to 9/11, my reviews were awful. They called me an alarmist, over the top, these aren't believable. Post 9/11, you know, it's everything from visionary to Nostradamus, and I don't think it's either of the two. I just did really good research, talked to a lot of people who had been in the region and understood that Islamic radical fundamentalism was a serious problem, not mainstream Islam, the 2 or 3% on the far end of the spectrum.
Do you ever get people who say to you, you know, you write these plots about these, you know, assassination attempts and these horrible things that could happen, you know, to our government or mm-hmm. whatnot, and they say, you're just giving the terrorist ideas. Do you get people who say
I get it all the time, but I think it's actually the reverse. I sit around all day, and I don't think the terrorists are as creative as I am, and I write these, and I know that a lot of people in Washington read them. In fact, the last book, Memorial Day, was put under security review by the Department of Energy and the NEST teams, the nuclear emergency support teams. The FBI had it mentioned in secure memos, CIA, Secret Service. And so the people in Washington are reading these books too. And I think it's helping, you know, them maybe look at some holes that they have in their security that they can plug up.
And you've done a lot of your research directly talking to CIA, FBI. Yep. I mean, people who were involved mm-hmm. in some of these operations, both covertly and otherwise.
Yeah, and I think the reason why they talk to me is that in my books, the terrorists are the villains. And then what I do is I kind of sing the praises of the unsung bureaucrat. In the book, I often say, you know, the special forces operator who makes the same as a Washington, D.C. bus driver, but works 7 days a week, puts his life on the line. I sing their praises, and then I pit that against corrupt politicians. Not necessarily corrupt, but politicians who are willing to put their own self-interest and the self-interest of their party in front of that of the country. And it strikes a chord with these bureaucrats who are out there, you know, trying to protect us.
And speaking of bureaucrats, one thing we can say about Consent to Kill, I love the characters you have from the U.S. Senate and some of the background of some mm-hmm. of these senators. I think especially political types out there will really enjoy some of those characters in this book. And one last thing about Consent to Kill, tell me, you're fairly proud about your Barnes & Noble ranking recently. Who did you just bump off?
Dan Brown.
Da Vinci Code.
Yes.
That's not a bad not a bad guy to bump off.
No.
And speaking of rankings, let's take a look at a graphic we have. You know, you're not the only one who has written a book. We just went past it. Yours was ranked number 11. We went by it kind of quickly. You were ranked number 11. My book, Inside the Ropes with Jesse Ventura, 492,694. So I don't have many people to pass to get up to you. So you think I might have a chance to bump you off?
But your book came out a long time ago.
Well, it was
much higher originally. I've only been out 1 week.
But it's always been in the thousands, but not quite that low. So anyway, a couple of St. Thomas grads, one yep. who's having a bit better luck at publishing a book than me. But congratulations on all your luck, and we hope to have you back on again, maybe when your eighth book comes out.
I would appreciate that.
All right, Vince
Flynn.
Thanks for being here. Appreciate it.